Now that we've spoken about the unity of consciousness, dissociation, as well as even voices of God and God, him or herself or itself, what does your background in schizophrenia, your perspective from there, have to say?
Yeah, well, that's a brilliant question and a leading question. It's what I wanted to comment on. Again, so many things have been unearthed here. You know, from the basic that all our beliefs, our fantasies, the hypotheses, illusions that are entrained by the sensorium to in a way that maintains some kind of synchrony between the inside and the outside. I think that's quite a fundamental thing which we haven't spoken about very much, but I just want to fully endorse. And of course, that entrainment, sometimes referred to, I think, as entrained hallucination, perception being hallucination that's just been entrained by sparse data. But the data themselves being actively sampled. So this loop that Yosha was referring to, I think, is absolutely crucial aspect of the whole sense making, and indeed sense making as a self, as the cause of my own or the author of my own sensations in an active sensing or active inference way. I think that's absolutely crucial. The question about are there multiple consciousness? I should just before addressing the psychiatric perspective. I have a group of colleagues, including people like Maxwell Ramstead and Chris Fields, and particularly Chris Fields, who takes a quantum information theoretic view of this and brings to the table the notion of an irreducible Markov blanket in a computing graph that crucially has some unique properties that means that it can only know of itself by acting on the outside or which other parts of the brain, and again acting in this instance just means setting the attention or the coordination or contextualizing message passing elsewhere. But the interesting notion, which is not unrelated to the pineal gland or Mark Soames's ascending neurotransmitter systems that might do this kind of action, is that there could be more than one minimal or irreducible Markov blanket that practically you can actually experimentally define in principle by looking at the connectivity of any kind. But certainly if you have sufficiently detailed connectome, you can actually define the Markov blankets in terms of the directed connections offered by external processes. And in principle, you should apply a kind of integrated information theory, but slightly nuanced, I think, in this instance, to actually identify candidates for irreducible Markov blankets that could be the thing that looks at the thing that's doing the thing that's, that may have different kinds of experiences. There could be an irreducible Markov blanket in say the globus pallidus that might be making sense of and acting upon the machinery that underwrites our motor behavior and our plans and our choices, as opposed to something in the occipital lobe that might be more to do with perception. So I'm just saying that I don't think it's a silly question to ask. Can we empirically identify candidates in computing architectures that would have the right kind of attributes that would be necessary to ascribe them some minimal kind of consciousness? But let me return to this key question about schizophrenia, because as Yosha was talking, it did strike me, yes, that's exactly what goes wrong in schizophrenia. Attribution of agency, delusions of control, hearing voice. Again, coming back to this notion that this action perception loop, this circular coupling to the world that rests upon action that has an agent, and that consciousness understood as self-modeling is all about ascribing the right agency to the outcomes of action, I think is a really important notion here. And it can go horribly wrong. you know, we spend the first, you know, years of our lives just working out I cause that and you cause that, and working out what I can cause and what I can't cause, and what mum causes and what other people cause. Imagine that you lost that capacity. Imagine that, you know, when you spoke, and this is Chris Frith's notion or expression for auditory hallucinations, for example, you weren't able to recognize that it was you that was the initiation of that speech act, whether it's actually articulated or subvocal. So just not being able to infer selfhood in the sense of ascribing agency to the sensed consequences of action would be quite devastating. And of course, you can think about reproducing these kinds of states with certain psychomimetic or psychedelic drugs. You know, they really dissolve what we take for granted in terms of a coherent, unitary content of consciousness. You know, if you've ever had the synesthesia can sometimes be deduced induced by psychedelic drugs, you will know what it's like to treasure the fact that the color is seen and sound is heard. It doesn't have to be like that. You know, it's just that if we, as sustained inferring processes, self-evidencing computing processes that sustain in a coherent way our sense-making, it looks as if colors are seen and sounds are heard. That's how we make sense of it. It doesn't have to be like that. And you can experience the converse. You can start to see sounds. You can hear colors. You can have horrible distortions of time perception. A moment can actually feel as if you've lusted, you know. So all of these things that we take for granted in terms of our sense making are so fragile that, you know, given the right either psychopathology or pathophysiology, technically a synaptopathy of the kind you might associate with things like Parkinson's disease and schizophrenia, possibly, you know, even neurotic disorders of sort of, you know, affective or depressive or generalized anxiety disorders, can all be understood as basically a disintegration of this coherent synthesis and, to use your word, the binding. Which means that I think the same principles could also be ascribed to consciousness itself. And, you know, I'm not sure, so depersonalization, derealization, I think are two conditions which I've never experienced, but my understanding of subjective reports from people who have, patients who have experienced these, do I think really speak to this notion that there could be multiple consciousnesses, and of course one will not be aware of the other, and possibly not even able to infer any agency, even if it was. But also, there could be no consciousness. You know, there are depersonalization syndromes where you still sense, you still perceive, but it's not you. And there are sort of derealization syndromes where you are there, all your sensorium is unreal. It's not actually there anymore. You're not actually in the world. So you can get these horrible disintegration, dissociative is a clinical term. You can get these situations where everything we take for granted about the unitary aspect of our experienced world and us as experiencers can so easily be dissolved in these conditions. So I take Yosha's questions very, very seriously. It's, and so would people who suffer from these conditions.
I would distinguish between consciousness and self more closely than you seem to be doing just now. I would say that consciousness coincides with the ability to dream, or it is the ability to dream even. And in schizophrenia, the dream is spinning off from the tightly coupled model that allows you to track reality. And when we dream at night, we are dissociated from our sensorium. And the brain is probably also dissociated in many other ways. And as a result, we get split off from the ability, for instance, to remember who we are, in which city we live in, what our name is, very often in a dream, even if it's a lucid dream where we get some agency over the contents of our dream, we might not be able to reconstruct our normal personality and crucial aspects of our own self. And in schizophrenia, I think this happens while we are awake, which means we start to produce mental representations that look real to us, but that have no longer the property that they are predicting what's going to happen next in the world or much later. And this ability to lose predictive power doesn't mean that they are now more of an illusion than before. There's the normal stuff that has predictive power is still a hallucination. It's still a trance state when you perceive something as real, as long as you perceive it as real. It's only some trance states are useful in the sense that they have predictive power, that they're useful representations, and others are not. And the ability to wake up from this notion that your representations are real is what Michael Taft calls enlightenment. He's a meditation teacher with a pretty rational approach to enlightenment. And basically to him, it's enlightenment is the state where you recognize all your mental representations as representations and become aware of their representational nature. You basically realize that nothing that you can perceive is real, because everything that you can perceive is a representational content. And that's something that is accessible to you introspection via introspection if you build the necessary models for doing that. And so when your mind is getting to this model level where you can construct a representation of how you're representing things, then you get some agency of how you are interacting with your representation. But I wouldn't say that somebody who is experiencing a schizophrenic episode and or derealizes or depersonalizes is losing consciousness. They're losing their self. They're losing coherence. They're losing the ability to track reality and the interaction between self and external world and so on. But as long as they experience that happening, they're still conscious. Does this make sense?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, certainly in terms of altered states of consciousness, absolutely. Yeah. Do you know Thomas Metzinger? Some of the things you've just said there were very reminiscent of, you know, his treatment of, say, phenomenal opacity and the like. Is he somebody that you have discussed these things with or subscribed to?
We discussed relatively briefly only. We met a few times since I left Germany only, mostly online. And I like Thomas a lot. I think that he is one of the few German philosophers worth reading right now. But of course, he's limited by being a philosopher, which means he is going to the point where before he stops before the point where he would make actually functional models that we could test.
Right. So
I think his concepts are sound. He does observe a lot of interesting things, and I guess a lot of it also through introspection. But I think in order to understand consciousness, we actually need to build testable theories. And I suspect even if we cannot construct consciousness as this strange loop, as Hofstadter calls it, from scratch, which I don't know whether we can do that, I'm agnostic with respect to that, we can probably recreate the conditions that lead to the discovery of consciousness in the brain, which means we can initiate the search process that the brain is initiating before it discovers it.
I was going to make the joke that we've offended physicists, neuroscientists, and now philosophers.
Yeah, it's my thing. it's mostly retaliation because I'm so offended by them. I shouldn't. I tried to study all these things and I got so little out of it. I found that most of it is just pretense. It's there's so little honest thinking going on about the condition that we are in. It was very, very frustrating to me.
If you enjoyed this Toe clipping, then the full video is linked in the description. You should also sign up for Toe Mail, which is again in the description and the pinned comment. You'll receive immediate access to all exclusive updates from the Theories of Everything podcast. It also helps me communicate directly with the core Toe community. You'll also receive my top 10 toes. Think of it as the intellectual version of Quentin Tarantino's obsession.